All right, I'm currently on the phone with Dustin. He's another musician that reached out about the interview session. So I'm going to go ahead and give him the chance to introduce himself.
Hey, everybody. My name's Dustin Ray. I'm a singer-songwriter in a band called The Mage Resolve. And yeah, that's who I am in a nutshell.
All right. Sounds good. Okay. So let's start at the beginning. Tell me about when you first came in contact with music and realized that it was something that you wanted to participate in.
Sure. So I grew up around music. My parents listened to music and all my cousins. So I was introduced to music at a very young age. I would say it wasn't until I was probably 8, 9 years old that I started watching MTV and listening to all the at the time glam rock bands and what have you, that I thought, man, that's what I want to do in some form or fashion. So that's when I first got into music, was just at an early age. My parents listened to Pink Floyd and Aerosmith and Uriah Heep, and it just went along the lines from there, from everything from Judas Priest to Iron Maiden to Cinderella to just all these bands and all this music I was around my whole life. And so it was a pretty early age that I wanted to do music from that standpoint. But I didn't actually get really into a band until I was in high school. So I'd say that's when I really took it serious.
I'm just going to jump in to interject and ask a couple questions about that time period. You mentioned that it wasn't until you're a little bit older until you started to realize that you could also participate yourself. Tell me a little bit about those steps, about when you began to realize that it was something that you could do, and then how did you go about picking the instrument you were going to play?
Sure. So it wasn't... I guess I kind of faked it for a long time, singing, because I didn't, I was poor growing up, my family couldn't afford any instruments. So I did a lot of singing. That was kind of my thing, was singing. And then were able to buy me a bass guitar. I think for one of my birthdays, maybe I was 12 or 13. And I take that back. They got me an acoustic guitar and ended up trading it for a bass guitar because I just fell in love with the bass. Just loved it. So that's kind of where I started. And that's kind of how I got into thinking, well, I learned how to play. The first song I learned how to play was a song called I Don't Believe in Love by Queensryche. Was the first bass song I ever learned to play. And I was like, wow, maybe I can do this.
Okay, so you started learning the bass guitar and singing as well?
Yes.
Okay. So tell me about the next steps there of working with the instrument and then becoming creative with it and starting to work on your own music.
Sure. Really in high school, when I got the bass and I started playing the bass and trying to sing, I couldn't do both. And it was a lot easier to find bands that needed bass players more so than any other instrument. So I kind of just learned and was kind of just going off of what the guitarist was playing. And that's kind of how I learned how to play the bass. Honestly, I didn't actually start writing my own music until I was probably 21, 22 years old. Then I started writing my own lyrics, coming up with my own guitar parts. I couldn't play them all. I would just come up with sections, but then I got a band together who had guitars who could put all those pieces together into a song.
Sure. So just to kind of recap there a little bit, as you became comfortable with the instrument, that was when you kind of developed the understanding of how to play. And then after, I'm going to say a couple iterations of different bands is when you kind of began to realize that you could also create with it.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, because I was, still timid and still didn't know a lot about the instrument, or more, it was more of a confidence thing as well. You know, fear of hitting the wrong note. So it took a while to get over that, that and just find the confidence. And the more you play, the more you do something, the more repetition, the easier it becomes and the better you become. So it was just, I was fortunate enough not to have a lot of friends. So, I sat in my room all day, listening to music and watching videos and just learning how to play.
Sure. So, I put a couple words in your mouth there by saying there was a couple different bands. Is that true? Was it a couple of bands that you're in, or was it one band that you stuck with to learn the instrument?
No, it was the same couple of guys, including myself, and we would try different bands, bringing in a new singer, bringing in a new drummer. And so, for the most part, it was the same group of guys. We just went through different phases of, well, let's do grunge. Here's a band name. Let's try this. So it kind of was dictated by who we got in the band and who would stay long enough to be able to actually write music. It was just a revolving door of musicians,
Yeah. That's unfortunately very common.
Yeah.
All right, so let's kind of move to the next step then. You did say at some point that you did begin to write your own material. Tell me a bit about that creative process and where that's led you.
Sure. So I started using the writing as far as lyrics go. I didn't know at the time, but it's like a form of therapy. It was just all emotion-based and situation-based. And so that's when I came into writing, doing more of the writing of the lyrics. I was trying to play bass and sing, couldn't do both. So I ended up just switching over to just being a singer, because then I could focus more on the lyrical aspect of it and going that route. So that's what I started doing, and that was kind of the process of getting me to where I'm actually at today. So went into a band as a singer, did pretty good for the local scene, quote unquote, and then got out of it. This was about 20 years ago. Got out of it. Life happened, got married, the whole spiel that goes on along with, almost everybody. And so then ended up coming back to it just over a year ago.
Okay, so tell me a bit about that process then of, rediscovering your love for it, getting back into it, and what project you're working on now.
Sure. throughout the time that I was in between music, I still kept writing, still kept playing on a guitar, just to my, kind of just to myself, with my thoughts and, to make a long story short, I was in a bad marriage. I was in the military. I was gone all the time, and then I ended up getting a divorce, remarrying. And it's funny, my kids and my wife found an old, demo CD that I had from back in the day. And they, were, hey, will you please, record some new stuff, please do, put something out. So that got me back into it, was just the encouragement of my family to, hey, you sit around, you play these songs to yourself. Can you please go and do something with them? So that's how I ended up where I'm at, man. So I'll be honest with you, or I would have just still been sitting in the house, just playing.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So, that's a great rediscovery for it. Tell me about where that has put you now. What are you working on?
Yeah. So, I went and bought a MacBook, got the Logic Pro. I was going to do everything myself, realized I'm not that good to do everything by myself. And so I ended up getting a hold of this recording studio down in Tennessee, called Tater Vision Records. And I sent an email saying, hey, I'm just trying to get some help with getting some parts married together, you know, instrument wise, and I'd like to record some vocals because I'm having a hard time doing it on my own. And I got an email back saying, hey, well, this is actually the studios for the artist on the label. Can you send me something, anything? And I was like, well, that's not really what I'm looking for. I'm just kind of looking to get 3-4 songs recorded, but I sent them something anyway. And then they got back to me and said, hey, Ryan Johnson's going to get a hold of you later on. And in my head, I'm thinking, okay, I don't know who this guy is. And so I ended up talking to him that night for about an hour and a half, and come to find out, he was the original guitarist in a band called 10 Years, they were big back in the early 2000s. And so he said, come on down, let's see what you got, let's see if we can work together. And went down there, we talked, we had the same interests, same ideas, and and that's kind of how it led to where I'm at today. Is we did a couple 3-4 songs, everything was going really good. So now we're working on, shoot, I think my 11th song, I believe. So yeah, so it was something that was unexpected. Like I said, I wasn't trying to, you know, do anything but be able to send it out to my friends and family, like, here, look, this is what I did. It's kind of cool. It's just my thing. And it's kind of, for me, I say blown up, because for me, it's gone so much better than I expected, as far as, you know, people liking the music. Not everybody likes the music, but people liking the music and just kind of where I'm at today. It's been crazy.
Sure. That's great. And congratulations on that. That's awesome.
Thank you very much.
What do you kind of see for yourself going forward? I imagine at some point there's going to be an album out. Are you going to put a band together and tour, or is it all kind of just a hobby? What's your vision for it?
You know, I'm kind of just going with the flow, to be honest with you. Yeah, I am going to put out an album. We're just releasing a single at a time, you know, and then at the end of it, we're going to put it together into an album. I do want to get a band together. That is the goal, just to go out and play and see how it sounds live, and really just to kind of have fun and just go from there. You know, originally I had no intention on a band or nothing at all. But now that I'm more into it, you know, I'm having so much fun. That is the goal, is to at least get out and play a couple of shows and, you know, hopefully find some players who want to play. Cause right now it's just me, in the band. Tater is recording most of the instruments, mixing, mastering, doing all that stuff. So it's really just me at this point. But if I could find people who wanted to play it and wanted to get up and was in my area, yeah, I'd love to get a band together and play out.
Awesome. Very cool. All right. So with everything that's happened to you, and the amount of time that you've been working in music and learning instruments and stuff, what are some of your favorite memories that have stood out to you and had an impact on the way that you stay motivated?
You know, there's a few. My first concert that my dad took me to, was Kiss, and Anthrax was opening up for him. That was the greatest thing ever that I'd ever seen in my life. So that has always stuck out to me, because I was always like, man, I'd love to be able to give that to somebody. You know, obviously you're talking about Kiss and Anthrax. They're upper echelon as far as I'm concerned of bands, but you know, that kind of feeling. And then, you know, just, you know, first time I got on stage and played, such a rush. It was a great time. It was amazing. And then, you know, as of late, being able to have a finished song and letting my family hear it and seeing their faces, that's all the memories I ever needed to have, was seeing that they're proud of me for doing it. And it's showing my kids as well. Hey, look, doesn't matter how young or how old, how experienced, how novice you are. If you, you just get out there and do it and just have fun with it. You know, you can do anything as long as you just put your, you know, your heart and soul into it. And it doesn't matter if you become rich, famous, whatever, you're doing it, be proud of that. And it, so, you know, that's kind of what I'm, that's all the memorable parts of this for me is that, you know, showing them that, hey, if this old man can get up and do something, you guys have nothing but the world in front of you to do what you want. You know?
That's a great message. And it's definitely something that I would also resonate with. That's perfect. All right. Well, where can people find you and check you out and then, you know, listen to the singles and stuff that you're putting out?
Sure. You can look, I'm on Facebook, The Major Resolve. I've got Spotify, Instagram, TikTok. You can also go to catervisionrecords.com. There's a bunch of, all the songs are there. There's video teasers promoting the songs are on there. I'm trying to think, oh, I'm on X or Twitter, whatever, whoever wants to call whatever it is. I'm on that as well. So pretty much all the social media sites, anybody can go out and listen to me there, or yeah, like I said, tatervisionrecords.com. Check, you know, you can check that out. That's the label I'm under. It's got me, it's got some other great bands on there too. So
all right, so I always like to give the person I'm interviewing the opportunity to put out their last word. So what's a message that you have that you want people to hear?
Yeah, you know, I would say what I'd want people to hear or take out of this is, you know, you're never too old. You're never too inexperienced. You're never, there's nothing that you can't do if you just put your mind to it. You can do anything. Just do it. It all it takes is one step. You just put one foot in front of the other. And when you're doing it, you know, make sure you're good to everybody else, good to the people around you, good to the people you don't know. You know, just be positive about everything. And just, you know, the main thing is just you can do it. You just got to take that first step. And while you're doing it, be kind to everybody else. So